This episode of the Disney Nerds Podcast is brought to you by DVC Resale Market. DVC Resale Market has become the leader in the DVC resale industry. They have sold over $400 million in DVC Vacation Club and have over 100 years of combined direct DVC experience. If you're looking to buy or sell, DVC Resale Market wants to put their knowledge and world-class service to work for you. Contact our friend Nick Cotton over at DVC Resale Market at www.dvcresalemarket.com.
Welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome. Welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast, a place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
A Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the Magic Worlds of Disney.
Hello and welcome to show number 398 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Hey, welcome back, everyone. On this week's show, we'll be catching up on the news, stories that are coming out of Walt Disney World. I don't know about you, but there are so many exciting updates lately that I can barely keep up. So with us tonight, we have Sam. Hi, Sam.
Mellissa, you are so right. So much news. So many new things coming. I feel like I was just there. We just talked about it, but now so much has changed. Let's talk about some news.
I know. I am so excited. And we also have Morgan. Hey, Morgan.
Hey, guys. How's it going? I don't know about you guys, but I can barely keep up, and I'm the one trying to post it to our website.
That's right.
Yeah, we are so grateful for you to post all the news stories on the Disney Nerds Podcast, and that's why we wanted to do this episode. So what we're going to do is go around and share a few of news recaps that we're most excited about, and all these stories and more can be found on the blog at thedisneynerdspodcast.com. So Sam, I want you to kick us off. What is one of the big news stories that you saw in the past 2 weeks that's really got you excited?
You know, I'll even go before that a little bit if I can cheat, because we did my trip report recently. Then as soon as I got back, fireworks started again. So fireworks are back. There's a bunch of pre-shows that are back, including Mickey and Winnie's Runaway Railway, the Haunted Mansion, Dinosaur. There's a sense of normalcy returning, including the crowd levels when they opened up a lot more capacity at the park. So it's good all the way around. We are definitely getting back to some sort of normalcy. So I love that, including a whole long list of things reopening that I just missed, like Casey's and the ice cream parlor, but it's all great.
It's something to look forward to when you go back.
This is exactly right, Morgan. Exactly right.
Yep. Going back for sure. And Sam, I did want to tell you, I heard that your problem that you experienced with Rise of the Resistance, where all the guests were populating and you had to go and quickly pick which guests were with you, that's been fixed again just after you left.
That's okay. But I'm just glad it's fixed, because it worked out for me in the 1 o'clock like we talked about. But I'm very happy to hear that's fixed, because I was feeling bad for people that hadn't been through it before, that weren't getting in because they had to take people out. And anyway, that's good to hear that it's fixed.
So apparently it will automatically select those guests in your My Disney Experience app that have a park reservation with you.
And that's what it should be.
You don't have to quit.
Yeah. That's perfect, because they know who's going to be there. So get the other people out of there and just let me go. So that's great. And hopefully capacity's increasing for that attraction and everybody gets the ride that wants to, and all of the other great things that are opening. That's for certain.
For sure. Morgan, what's top of your mind?
I think what's on top of my mind is today, the day that we're recording, I just updated the what's opening, what's closed, what's being refurbished, the whole long list. And I think the big part about that is we have four resorts we got opening dates for them.
That is awesome. And I think, Morgan, it's the rest of them that haven't been opened, right?
Right. So,
good.
We found out that All Star Music is going to open September 16th, Port Orleans Riverside, October 14th, Port Orleans French Quarter, October 28th, All Star Sports, December 9th. So, but, and they also did say that all of the resorts they are planning to have open by the end of the year. So if your favorite resort is not open yet, it should be open by the end of the year.
You know, the one I am so happy to hear is Riverside. I miss Riverside. I really like that place.
And I actually stayed in French Quarter, but I've never stayed in Riverside. So now I'm excited because maybe I can finally mark that off my bucket list.
There you go.
Yeah, I am most excited to hear Riverside and Port Orleans open. I'm going to go over and have a beignet and a po' boy.
There you go.
I was very excited about that. And actually, it's kind of funny. In my memories on my Facebook page today popped up when I did the beignet dash at Port Orleans.
Was that, what was that? Like a 5K-ish? Or
it was almost a 5K. It was less than a 5K. And I did it about 3 years ago. And this was actually a lot of the resorts, more the moderate and some of the deluxe, were doing some kind of resort run. Mm-hmm. And the beignet dash was like the first one. And once you finish the beignet dash, you got beignets.
Oh, I'm running.
So I was super excited. I, of course, posted it with a picture of me and my friend doing it. And she even was like, I want them to bring it back. Let's do this again. So hopefully this means we also get those resort runs because I want to mark all of those off my list too.
Yes. I hope they all come back. I know Boardwalk did one. They all do. That's awesome.
And I've only been able to do two. I've done the Beignet Dash and the Yacht Club one called the Regatta Run.
Regatta Run. I like it. Yeah. All right. I was going to say, so I went, Morgan went. It's your turn, Mellissa. And then we'll just go around the circle again.
Yeah.
So, well, speaking of dashing around to get beignets, RunDisney is back. And I know that's so exciting for people. I would love someday to participate. And I have not yet. But we've got confirmation that the Wine and Dine Wickedly Delicious is going to be back for November 4th through the 7th. We've got the Princess Half for February 24th through the 27th. And then the Marathon, skipping back to January, the 5th through the 9th of January. And then, of course, the Princess Half in February, as I mentioned, and then the Springtime Surprise, right in time for April Fools, which will be the end of March, early April, and more details to come on that. But signups are starting, I think, next week, right, Morgan?
Yep. And one interesting thing, so I've mentioned it before on previous shows, I have done races. I love doing the races, which doesn't matter what shape you are, you can do a 5K. You know, there's no rule that says, you know, you have to be in tip-top marathon shape. You can do a 5K. That's only 3 miles.
You can walk it, too, by the way.
You can walk it.
Yeah.
Yeah. One thing that's kind of interesting is what they used to – there's a couple of things for us RunDisney people. If you look at the details that were on the post that we did, Club RunDisney, which is a paid club, quote-unquote club, that you can pay for, has advanced registration. It used to be pass holders and DVC members had advanced registration, and now they've taken that away. And so they now, if you're not part of Club RunDisney, you register with the general public, which is usually a week or so after the advanced registration. So that's kind of interesting. It's kind of like they're making you want to do Club RunDisney if you weren't doing it for some reason.
They're sort of making Club RunDisney the annual pass of the RunDisney events, right?
And a lot of people weren't doing it because they were getting advanced registration being a pass holder or a DVC member. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there was no kind of draw unless you were just an uber RunDisney fan. So, I mean, that's kind of caused a little bit of stir, but I don't think it's going to be that bad. Hopefully, you know, people will still be able to get to register. But then another cool thing I thought was cool is that March-April race that they're calling the summer, what, the Springtime Surprise? Is that what they're calling it?
Yep, Springtime Surprise.
That's usually, in April is usually when they did the Star Wars race.
Oh.
So they've gotten rid of the Star Wars race, and now they have this Springtime Surprise that they haven't given us a lot of details on.
Hmm.
So I'm intrigued by that.
That's an interesting theory. Yeah, we'll have to hold tight and see what they release on that race. They still are going to have the virtual race available. So if you can't make it down, Morgan, do you plan to do any of the virtual races?
I did the virtual race for the summer last summer just because I liked the theme. They are doing one this summer. It's Lion King theme. I'm sure it's probably sold out because they normally sell out. The medals, Disney medals are really cool. They put a lot of work into them. But to me, part of the fun is running in the park and having those character stops and that whole experience, even going to the expo. So I am not going to do anything else Run Disney wise virtually, just because I rather spend my money and do in person. So I am leaning towards, I'm not going to do the wine and dine, even though I will be able to do it for like the 10K if I wanted, but it's going to be pushing it time wise. I'd have to take an extra day off work, but I already told everybody I'm doing one next year. I'll either do Princess or I'll do that springtime surprise. I just haven't figured out which one, but I'm definitely at least one of them doing next year. I'm back.
The Princess one has a yoga day that was really intriguing to me. So maybe twist my arm.
And the Princess one, the first Run Disney race I ever did was the Princess races. It was the Frozen 5K. And the funny thing is, it was really cold that morning. So they like, Disney World like brought in the frozen weather too.
There's a Hurricane Elsa joke there, but I'm going to stay away from it.
Yeah. But it's funny because I didn't pack like a long sleeve shirt. I had to borrow one from my friend who was doing the half marathon that weekend. But yeah, like that one race got me hooked. I will stick with 5Ks, maybe a 10K. I will not do them both. I did that for the Star Wars race and I was tired, but yeah, I'm excited. I cannot wait to do those races again.
Yeah. Really excited to see and happy for all those runners that you'll be able to have that in-person component again. So
good. And you know, Mellissa, we can do, and we can coordinate, share a room that way, you know, we can work it out.
I'm really tempted. I told my family not too long ago, I really would want to do something someday. And if I did, it has to be Disney.
Yeah,
sure.
So Sam, we're back to you.
All right, back to me. I want to talk about the 50th celebration because there's a whole bunch of things I'm going to wrap into one here. Some of it we may have talked about in the past, but I just think it's shaping up to be a bigger and bigger October 1st, 2021, the 50th anniversary of Walt Disney World. You know, the kickoff of that 18-month long celebration. We already knew that Harmonious is going to be a part of that. We already knew that Remy's Ratatouille Adventure was going to be part of that. But now what we've learned is we have a brand new nighttime show over at the Magic Kingdom. It's going to take the Cinderella projections all the way down Main Street, which is something they've done at Disneyland before. But we are absolutely looking forward to Disney Enchantment, that new nighttime spectacular at Magic Kingdom. Wow. Now, where do I want to be? Magic Kingdom or Epcot? I'm not sure. But add to that, now we also know there's a Kite Tells event coming, which is a daytime celebration at Animal Kingdom that's going to feature three-dimensional kites over at the Discovery River, wind catchers, kites of all shapes and sizes, three-dimensional kites along the water. The concept art shows jet skis pulling Simba and Zazu and Blue and King Louie. The kites will dance through the sky to the beat of our favorite Disney songs. And if that's not enough, they're also introduced the Disney Fab 50. The Fab 50 are the introduction of 50 unique character sculptures, the small little golden ones that used to be around the hub, 50 of those all over the four Disney parks that will quote unquote interact in surprising ways.
Boom. And they're actually rose gold.
They're rose gold. That's even cooler.
Yeah, because if you look at the castle has these rose gold features. Sure though.
So all that's so much going on. I mean, Animal Kingdom sounds really cool.
And if you look at the photo or the little 10-second video that's on our post.
Yes.
If you look closely, that's the Rivers of Light Theater that you're sitting at.
Yes, it is. And they call that out. It is the Discovery River Amphitheater. Yes, that's where it's happening, which tells me no new nighttime thing at Animal Kingdom, but a performance that's going to happen multiple times a day.
Yeah,
that's kind of cool.
But you know what's funny? And this is semi on topic. I was browsing magic bands today that you can pre-order for your trip.
Ooh.
And there was a Rivers of Light magic band.
Hmm.
I saw that.
And old I haven't seen or, that. Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
I haven't seen it before. So that makes me think, are you going to have this kite show during the day, multiple shows during the day? And then are we getting Rivers of Light back?
You know what? I hope there's more stuff coming, because it seems like every time we turn around, they're announcing new things for this 50th.
Yeah. And I feel like us as Disney nerds, we're like investigating every little announcement and seeing if there's like subtle hidden things for what else is to come. And they're not telling us yet. Like, I feel like I'm a detective trying to figure it all out.
And this whole interacting with those 50 character sculptures, I can't wait to see this. With some of the things they've done in the interactive queues. In fact, Mellissa, something I forgot to talk about in the trip report, in the Toy Story queue for Toy Story Mania, my kids are playing with the app, and they're showing me all the different interactive things in the Toy Story queue that I didn't even know were there. Like, this is really cool.
And is that how we're going to interact with the sculptures? Is it going to be in the app?
You have to wonder, but I can't wait. If a sculpture moves, or if there's some music, or if it lights up, surprising ways is what they say in the press release. So, yeah. Wow, that could be anything.
And what I think is cool is, well, what I'm hoping right now, they've already said with the tickets and stuff in the app, is only for Apple users. So I'm hoping for Android users, they're going to have that available for them before October 1st. So Android users aren't left out.
I'm sure somewhere somebody's got that on a project list.
Well, they need to bump it up for the Android. I'm an Apple user, but you know, they got to bump it up for the Android users.
The other thing coming for the 50th, Mickey's Philharmagic.
Yes. Upgrade. The Un Poco Loco, which is the new musical number being added. Now, the interesting thing there is it's going to debut in California, at California Adventure, and at Disneyland Paris later this month. And then they're going to bring it to Disney World as part of the 50th, which is another reason to get the Magic Kingdom. You got new fireworks there, and you got the new, I don't know where to go when we're there. So much to see.
Yeah, I'm not only excited for the 50th enhancements, right? Mickey's Philharmagic at Magic Kingdom and the light effect on the Main Street, mm-hmm. but just thinking ahead after the 50th, how easy we could see plug and play now into Mickey's Philharmagic of adding more current films. This will be, I believe it's the first Pixar film to be added to the film. We also, you know, thinking of Main Street overlay, that could easily turn into extra Halloween, extra Christmas decorations that get added. And can you just imagine all the snow coming down and the buildings added with those, you know, overlays will just be really, really neat to see, not only for the 50th, but what's to come in the future then.
I'm really looking forward to how they integrate this. That's an effect that Disneyland has used for quite some time. But if you think about it, if you're standing on Main Street in Disneyland, you really can't see the castle that clear because it's much smaller than Cinderella's castle. So they project it onto the building so you can look. But this one seems different because it's going to flow from Cinderella's castle down Main Street, which may make the train station the ultimate place to see this whole thing happen.
You just told everybody my special spot that I wasn't going to.
It's closed right now. Yeah, I'm sorry. Shh, don't tell anybody.
Darn. I was going to camp out there, which I mean.
You're still going to camp out there. Don't give me that.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I am going to camp out there. But one thing is, you know, we're going to be there for the 50th. Sam, you're going to be there too.
Yep.
I know we're going to be on the first, we're going to be in Epcot. The day before, we're going to be in Magic Kingdom. And on the second, we're going to be in Magic Kingdom. So one of those days, we're going to be able to experience this new show.
That's right.
And my job is to convince Jimmy to go to the train station.
If it's open. So that's the one thing I'd love. I mean, so being there recently, you do the people mover and take a look at Tron, and the train track just isn't there yet.
Yeah.
Makes me wonder when the train's going to reopen. In fact, the train station is completely behind tarps right now.
Yeah.
The whole thing.
I mean, I've got some other ideas for good viewing, you know, sure. So I'll divulge that, you know.
After.
Hopefully, I got to test the theories out. I don't want to just say, hey, everybody, go to this spot because it might That's be right. a bad spot.
That's right.
You have to go a couple of times and check out different spots.
This is right.
Well, luckily, I have like 3 trips in like 2 months going on. So
That's
between
good.
The 50th, our meetup, and then, you know, going to be there for the expo, the House of Mouse expo that we're going to be a part of.
That's right.
You know, I got 3 chances in the fall to figure out that good spot.
It'd be a go-to for tips, Morgan.
Yep. And for a small fee. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
Well, what else is on your list?
Oh, my gosh. I mean, if the 50th wasn't enough, which it is, I'm excited because we got food and wine back. And it's not Taste of.
This is right. It's not Taste of.
So July 15th, Food and Wine Festival going through November 20th. But we got the menus.
That, oh, all right. Right there. Stop. First of all, it's you said those dates really quickly. That's 129 days of Food and Wine Festival.
Right. But what's funny is if you look at the menus, not all the booths are opening until October 1st.
Quite a few of them. And in fact, Disney also said that a couple would be added later in July. And I think what they're doing, well, if you think about it, there were always more booths for Food and Wine than Flower and Garden.
Yeah.
So I think it's easy to swap those Flower and Garden to Food and Wine, but now you got some others you got to drag out from the back.
And every year until COVID, it seems like they were always adding more.
Yes.
They were always upping the ante. Mm-hmm. So I'm excited. And of course, this year it's sponsored by Corksicle, which if you guys aren't familiar with Corksicle, they are like the go-to cup to keep your wine and your cocktails nice and chilled while you're drinking them, which of course means there's going to be some Corksicle cups for sale. And
oh, well, I'm sure
I'm going to be purchasing one, at least one. Might have to get 2. Mom might steal mine. But of course we do have Emile's Fromage Montage back, which a lot of people loved last year. And then we've got,
wait a minute, what's back?
Emile's Fromage Montage.
What is that?
It is, you're going to get 5 different, this is from the website. You're going to go to your festival passport. You're going to select five select marketplace purchases for delicious cheese dishes.
Okay.
You get a stamp, and then you go to the Shimmering Sips Marketplace for a special prize.
I like prizes.
Yep. And if you guys don't know, Emile is Remy's brother from Ratatouille.
So
is this the adult version of Ratatouille's Hide and Squeak?
I think so, but I don't see, I mean, it's cheese dishes. So unless you're lactose intolerant like I am, you can enjoy regardless of age.
That's true.
Yeah. Me, I'm going to be popping a bunch of lactate pills to enjoy, but still.
Yeah, it's a necessary thing with Food and Wine because there are so many tasty things there that have, yeah, milk, cheese.
I mean, hey. We've already had the show of what do we pack in our park bag, and I've already said lactate pills are in my park bag. So
I'm really interested in some of the new booths that they premiered already. One of them being the Lobster Landing, which
yes.
is going to open
in time
a
great
for
name.
The 50th.
Love that.
Yeah, and it's going to be by a Mission Space, so I'm assuming there's going to be lobster. I've always really enjoyed the lobster po' boy or sandwich that's typically been over in the American Adventure.
Yeah.
And it's big pieces of claw meat. They are not skimping out on that. And it's one of the more expensive ones, but for the what you get, it's a really good deal. So I'm hoping that's going to be over there.
So I haven't seen a map, but you said this one's by Mission Space.
Yep. So
if I'm thinking correctly, that's the furthest towards the front of the park these things have been, because the test kitchen was really the closest to the front.
Yeah, near test track. And so so the Lobster Landing is one of the ones that's going to open October 1st. And check out listen to the menu. This is why Mellissa's so excited. You got New England lobster tail with lobster bisque sauce. Lobster chowder with bacon, corn, potatoes, and oyster crackers. Or should I say chowder?
There you go, Lisa.
And then you got baked lobster dip with Old Bay chips. And this is your gluten wheat friendly option on this menu.
Gluten wheat friendly, sure, whatever. I like it.
Yeah. But that's one thing I've noticed is they are making sure that most of the booths do have a gluten wheat friendly option or a plant-based option or dairy. Like they're being inclusive with people with allergies, which is awesome to see.
Yes, it is.
Sam, so I think the closest booth though, from what I'm seeing, is going to be near Disney Traders. So you're going to walk straight in, right? Because Disney Traders is the new Mouse Gear name. And you're going to walk in, you're going to see Spaceship Earth, you're going to see guest relations, and boom, there's going to be a booth. And it's called the Swinky Saucy Swine.
Nice.
Yes, I saw that one.
And you know, that's all part of this Epcot transformation and the center being World Celebration. And we heard again and again that one of the goals is to bring the festivals closer to the front of the park, because you had to previously almost get the World Showcase before you saw some of the festivals. And they want to bring it all the way up to the front of the park to let all of Epcot enjoy these things.
Yep.
One other thing you said there, Morgan, you said the lobster thing near Mission Space isn't until October 1st.
Right. According to the post, that's one of the ones that's not going to open until October 1st.
And I was thinking backwards, though. I'm thinking, well, something else opening there October 1st. We haven't gotten a date for Space 220 yet. We know the Play Pavilion's off the table, but Guardians isn't going to be ready. It's Remy that's going to be ready for October 1st.
Yep.
There seems to be a number, when you go through the post, a number of booths that are opening October 1st that aren't necessarily around Spaceship our Mission Space. So could there be a connection? Yeah, but I think it might just be extra food options for
a busier park
for the 50th.
Yeah. Maybe there's some walls that might come down before then. That'd be nice to see. Who knows?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely think that, well, also if you think about it, if you're a regular Disney goer, you usually go to Food and Wine every year if you can. You plan that trip for the fall. So, you know, people that go in the summer, they're not used to having the Food and Wine as something to do.
That's right.
So that could have another thing to do with, like, you know, hey, let's hold off till October 1st, because that's when some of the regulars are going to come anyway. That might have something to do with it as well. But who knows? But I mean, all I got to tell you is I'm going through the list when I was looking at all the food, and I got even more hungry than before.
And I'm just going to need to bring stretchy pants and Lactaid and just going to roll me out of there.
You're going to go to our sponsor, Lost Princess Apparel, get you some cute Disney leggings. There's your stretchy pants. You know, I'll have the Lactaid pills. You know, I'm willing to share, but if I go run out, you guys got to pitch in, you know, and we'll just eat our way around all of Epcot, not even World Showcase. There's all of Epcot.
How many booths are on there?
Let's see. Let me count.
I wasn't asking to count, but yeah, there's a lot going on, is my point.
Yeah. And
those little books get thicker and thicker and thicker.
Honestly, I'm wondering if this is not all of the booths, to be completely honest, because the list is long, but I don't feel like it's that long for Food and Wine.
Maybe there's more coming. Well, they did say that more things are coming October 1st, and more things from the opening day is next week, and there were more being added in July.
Yeah,
for that release.
So I am excited about that.
So speaking of food, I'm going to continue our food theme.
Yeah,
Salt and Straw.
Ooh.
This is going to be up your alley, Sam. Do you know about Salt and Straw?
I have visited Salt and Straw in Disneyland's downtown Disney. It's ice cream, so yes, I've had it, and it's really good.
It's ice cream. I did not know anything about it, so I had to look up the company, and this will be the first one that will be, besides Miami, on the East Coast. They all seem to be on the West Coast, so it's a little bit of a West Coast thing, and looking at 2022 for Disney Springs. We don't have a date yet, just this next year, but really interesting flavors that they have. So for example, one right now is goat cheese Marionberry habanero. They do have your classics, but I don't think this is going to be your run-of-the-mill ice cream shop over at Disney Springs. This is going to be that place that you get some pretty interesting flavors like olive oil. And I saw there was a goat cheese and pear or blue cheese and pear. So great stop to try out some unique flavors you might not be able to get at
home. It's a perfect substitution for the Ample Heels that never opened, if you ask me. So it's a perfect fit.
And if you think about it, Disney Springs does seem to have a lot of dessert type options as far as ice cream and pastries and donuts and cookies and things like that. So it's kind of cool that Salt and Straw is, yes, we're going to have your typical flavors, but they're going to have some unique ones that are kind of draw more people in because they're going to want to go there instead of Ghirardelli or one of the other ice cream places like the gelato place.
Right.
You know, they gotta make it different. So exactly, I'm glad it's not going to be a typical ice cream place.
And clearly, if this is opening next year in 2022, I expect that it's probably going to go where that Ample Hills was supposed to go, which is all the way over by MBA and by Cirque du Soleil, all the way on the other side from where Ghirardelli's is. So it's not even close. They're way. Yeah. It's kind of like the two Starbucks they have at Disney's for their way.
So that would actually make sense because you've got Ghirardelli on one end. You got the gelato place over by Boathouse. So that's kind of like, you know, middle of Disney Springs.
Yes.
And then you're going to have Salt and Straw at the end. So that works.
It does. And it's a perfect fit. I think that's awesome. Disney was able to do that.
So Sam, you can hit all three.
You can easily hit all three of those in one trip. Yes, you can. Absolutely.
Works for me.
Sam, we're back over to you.
We're back to me. Did we talk on the show about the Contemporary and the Incredible Rooms? If so, we'll just skip over it. But
you mentioned on your trip report last week.
Okay, so I mentioned it.
There were the tarps up, but we didn't talk or really describe the room that we've seen or the info that we know. So
since then, Disney shared images and photos of the newly redesigned dash of incredible rooms that are now in the Contemporary. I think they look great. And Mellissa, I think you commented to the Moana rooms over at Pauly, and they look great. It's just a little bit of the Incredibles. Looks awesome. They're bringing it to the Contemporary. Look, the Contemporary is supposed to be like you're staying in Tomorrowland, so it's a perfect segue. That's where the Incredibles are. I like it a lot. They also said in that press release that the wave of American flavors is scheduled to be refurbished before the 50th. And I think we had commented before that the rumors are spinning that it's going to be the Incredible Steakhouse. Don't know if that's true or not, but so stuff going on over there and all of the Monorail resorts, bringing new things to those.
I want to say if you guys have ever stayed in the Contemporary Resort, they were always beautiful rooms, but one thing, they never felt Disney. They just felt like a really nice luxury room. And they also, in my opinion, were like a little dark. Like the woods were a little dark. So it was just a little dark in coloring. So to see this, like get this little Disney uplift, you've got whites, you've got these bright colors. You know, you're going to open up the closet and you're going to see the incredible suits hanging in the back. That's going to be really cool. So I'm excited for that. And also, I'm glad they're not messing with the bathrooms too much because those were really beautiful bathrooms.
I really love the Edna Mode pillow. That may not just fall into my suitcase.
No, I bet you,
it's a cute touch.
I bet you money that there's going to be one of those books on the table or the dresser or somewhere. It's going to tell you, if you want to take this pillow home, it will be blah, blah, blah dollars.
Yeah. So, and sure probably available in the gift shop in the lobby of the Contemporary.
Right.
So that's the Incredibles coming to the Contemporary. We know the Moana rooms we saw a couple of months ago over at the Pauly. And now Citrico's over Grand Floridian. is getting an area where guests can dine underneath the lovely London sky. It's a garden setting inspired by Mary Poppins Returns. With the glow of decorative lamps and chandeliers, it's taking bookings now. It opens on July the 15th. So basically, now you have Mary Poppins coming more and more into the Grand Floridian. Remember, the Grand Floridian is like staying on Main Street USA. The Pawleys like staying in Adventureland, and the Contemporaries like staying in Tomorrowland. That's where those themes came from, and I think it's wonderful. More characters in those.
Yep. And Grand Floridian already had a little bit of Mary Poppins theme, because if you go into the DVC building, there was this really, really cute fountain with the penguins from Mary Poppins. But you even in the rooms, you had little Disney touches. I remember when I stayed at Grand Floridian, in the bathroom there was this really cool black and white picture of Alice in Wonderland, which still fits into that Main Street USA theming.
Sure does.
So I'm excited because they're putting more Disney IP into the resorts, but because they're deluxe resorts, it's not going to be so overly saturated that you're going to just feel like you're walking into a movie like you do when you go to like All-Star Movies.
And that's okay. I think it fits very nicely.
I'm perfectly fine with that. Give me a little taste of Disney, regardless of what resort I'm staying in.
I've seen the pictures, and I highly recommend going to our blog post to see the pictures of Citrico's. I love the pops of the fabrics and the new tables.
And I've never done Citrico's, so it was always on my list, but now it's a little bit higher because I really want to see those, you know, Mary Poppins Returns vibes going on in that restaurant.
Yeah, definitely recommend. It was very good. We've been there a couple of times. All right. I think, Morgan, you're up.
Oh, wow. What do I pick? There's like so much to pick. We're kind of sticking on the food theme here. Looks like Galaxy's Edge Batu is finally getting some new dishes.
Cool. Where? I missed this. Help me.
Well, I feel like this was kind of an issue because I feel like the selection was a little slim ever since day one in Galaxy's Edge. So I think Disney's finally got on the ball and given us some extra dishes. Like over at Docking Bay 7, we're going to get some, like, we're going to get like a chicken salad. You're going to get like a tuna poke. There's going to be, they called it a Batuan beef and crispy tapado stir fry.
Mm.
Which sounds great to me. Smoky braised beef glazed in tamarind sauce served with stir fried vegetables, crispy herb yuca, pickled onions, and cilantro. That just sounds delicious to me.
I really enjoyed Docking Bay originally when they had the wraps and things. So that's really interesting, some of the additional menu items.
And of course, they are going to do probably a little bit more familiar things. Like they are going to do some pork rinds, which I think is kind of cool because pork rinds still kind of gives you that like otherworldly, you know, feel to it. And the picture that they have on our post, they're actually in the mouse droid popcorn bucket.
Yes, I see it. Yes, that's exactly what that is.
So my thought is, instead of buying popcorn, if I buy the pork rinds, am I getting that popcorn bucket? Is that, are we swapping the popcorn for pork rinds now?
Sure, why not? Why not?
I'm okay with that. And then, of course, if you don't want to eat in Batu, you can head over to Sunset Boulevard at Hollywood Studios, and we're getting some hot dogs and some cool things like that over there. So Hollywood Studios is finally getting some extra food stuffs, which I'm excited about.
That's good. And I like all the Star Wars names associated with some of those menu items. It's the chicken tip, yep, and things like that that are tying back into some of the latest cartoons. And one thing I got to say, I was a little disappointed in the popcorn stand within Galaxy's Edge isn't opened. And I don't know if you guys are watching Bad Batch or not, but they've been enjoying that mix of popcorn on the Bad Batch. And I'm like, how cool.
So they got to bring the popcorn back.
Galaxy's Edge, and that's what these guys can't wait to finish their mission and go back and get the Midorian mix is what they're eating on the show, but it's the same as the Batu mix, but apparently the mix is based on the planet you're on, but it's the same thing.
Gotcha. So yeah, I mean, they got, if they're putting in Bad Batch, they got to open that popcorn stand.
Yes, I was disappointed. that it wasn't open, because I'm like, I got to try it again, because they're eating it. The cartoon, they're throwing it up in the air, catching it in the mouth.
Well, speaking of Disney Plus and Bad Batch, I'm going to kind of pivot away from food and go to Encanto, which the trailer dropped today. We're recording on Thursday the 8th. And well, we also saw the poster. Sounds like November of this year. I'm going to guess around Thanksgiving. That tends to be when these kind of movies premiere, but we don't have a date yet. It just says November of 21. Not sure either if it's going to be theater or Disney Plus. I would imagine kind of what we saw with Luca, maybe hitting Disney Plus or maybe some sort of premiere access, but more to come on that. But the soundtrack is going to be from Lin-Manuel Miranda. So fame for being in Mary Poppins Returns and Hamilton. And I cannot wait for the soundtrack. It sounds, even just the trailer music sounds great. And it's basically, from what we can tell, the trailer, this kind of magical, fantastical family, and the house maybe is a little bit enchanted as well. And set somewhere in Latin America kind of feel to it. And the main character, it appears, her name is Maribel, and she does not have a gift like her family. So maybe her journey on discovering her true gift and what she brings to the family. So really looking forward to that movie. It looks really colorful and fun.
Yeah, I'm excited about that. I've already watched it, I think, three times, just because the trailer is just so fun.
There's a lot of Mary Poppins-ish type things going on, which I thought was interesting. I look forward to seeing it.
Yeah. So, I mean, that is going to be great. And I think the fact that it's not saying exclusive to Disney Plus, I feel like it's either going to be straight to theaters, or we're going to have a premier access Disney Plus and theater option, so you can pick and choose. That's my opinion.
So speaking of Disney Plus, since we got there, the new Monsters, Inc. story, if you guys haven't seen that, it dropped yesterday, two episodes. It's really good.
It is. I watched it and I can't wait for more.
I thought the same thing. So at first I'm watching it with my kids and I'm like, man, that really sounds like Billy Crystal, doesn't it?
Yep.
And that's a good impersonation of John Goodwin. And then I go, wait a minute, it is them. I Googled it.
Yep. So I had to look it up too.
Cast. Yes. That's pretty cool. The way that they pulled off, this new Monsters, Inc. series. My youngest son immediately said, are they going to tie this into Laugh Floor? Because it seemed like there was a lot. I'm like, well, there's the eight episodes to go. Let's see, maybe.
And that, honestly, like that's a perfect way for them to put it into Laugh Floor.
Yes.
You know, you've got to zhuzh up Laugh Floor just because it's been around for a while. So what better way than to tie this new Disney Plus series, which is great, into an already existing attraction?
Yeah. Tie these characters that you now have into it. Yeah. It's got a lot of potential. It's definitely worth a watch if you haven't watched it.
So, Sam, are they 30-minute episodes, hour-long episodes?
The 25-minute mark. Yeah.
Half an hour. They went by quickly. I think when you watch anything on Disney Plus, it says it's 26 minutes, but like the last 3 minutes are credits.
Yeah. Sure. But I do have to say, for the second episode, watch the whole credits, because there's a funny little song that Mike does, and that's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, it was good.
Well, I'm going to have to add it. We do a Friday night Disney movie night where we try to pair food and a Disney film and watch it together. So I think that will be our Friday night. So here's what
if you want to get in front of the kids on that one, bring banana bread.
Banana bread. All right. Taking notes.
And actually, what you can even do is the show takes off right after Monsters, Inc. So you could even watch Monsters, Inc., you know, and then go right into Monsters at Work, because it takes off right after the movie's over.
Morgan, I think you're up next. We'll do one last round here.
Well, since we're talking Disney Plus and shows and everything like that, not only did we find out about Encanto, but we got the trailer for the Marvel Studios' first animated series called What If? And it looks amazing. So this is going to come out August 11th. Their new episode is going to do Wednesdays like Loki's doing. And if you look at I feel like you can watch the trailer multiple times and see something you didn't notice before. Like, I feel like this trailer is full of Easter eggs that even I probably won't see them, understand them all. But basically, the story is, what if, because it's called What If because there's different Marvel universes. So, for example, what if Agent Carter became Captain America? So she's Captain Carter. You know, what if, you know, Tony Stark didn't get blown up by their grenade and was saved? There's all these different scenarios, and this series is going to go into them, and it's really, really cool.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that one as well. Will it start right when Loki's ending? Does that sound about right?
I don't know when the last day for Loki is. What If starts August 11th. So I don't know when the last episode of Loki is going to be.
It'd be interesting to see if there's any tie-in to some the time variance or anything with the What If aspect.
Well, like if you watch the trailer, there is somebody kind of narrating it. And if I'm not mistaken, he calls himself the Watcher. And so he's kind of watching over these multiple universes. So you kind of wonder, you know, is he part of the time variance? Is this a whole other thing? Like, what is this, you know, world that we're about to explore with What If?
Very interesting. Yeah, I can't wait to see that. And being an animated series, that'll be new for us. Well, my last notable news was the Destination D23 dates being announced. A couple of weeks back, they were announced, but we will see that coming back. So November 19th to the 21st in Walt Disney World, Contemporary will be the base for the event. And tickets will go on sale in July, I would assume the next couple of weeks, for Gold members. So if you're not a D23 Gold member yet, definitely go and get signed up and check out the events. Are either of you going to be able to attend?
If I can get tickets, I would love to go. We'll leave it at that.
Well, let's put all of our positive thoughts and wishful thinking into Sam getting tickets, because that is the only weekend in November that I will not be there. And it's kind of funny. So, you know, as you guys know, we have our meetup on the 12th and 13th of November. I'm coming in the weekend before, so I'll be there for the first two weekends. Then we have Destination D, which I'll be home. Then I come back after Thanksgiving to help out with the House of Mouse Expo that we're going to be a part of. So, of course, I messaged Jimmy and I'm like, the one weekend we're not already going to be there. They do Destination D. Yeah. So I am going to put all of my positive vibes that Sam can get tickets and cover this for us.
I'm going to do my best. It is supposed to be all about the 50th. So, you know, me and Disney history, I would love to be there if I can be.
Yeah, I would love to be there, too. It just was like, oh, not that weekend. Pick a different weekend. But yeah, it's going to be so cool. I remember seeing photos of the last Destination D. And even though it's not as big as the D23 Expo, it's still a fun thing to go to and see. Especially, we haven't had an expo in how many years now, Sam?
Yeah, since 19. It was supposed to be, just hasn't happened.
So, I mean, we've had a full year without any kind of expo. At least Destination D is usually the opposite year of the D23 Expo. So we need an expo in our lives.
That's right.
Well, that's lots of news. Any other news?
I'm looking forward to one thing on Disney Plus, and that's the new Behind the Attraction series.
Which we haven't heard anything else about yet.
We haven't, other than it's a 10-part series, and they're getting into a whole bunch of Disney attractions and how they were made, and I can't wait to see this.
Yeah, I'm waiting for more details. I'm waiting to find out that release date, because, you know, I think I've watched the Imagineering story 50 times already. I need something else in my rotation.
Yes, and this is right there with the Imagineering story, and I want to say that I have a release date somewhere. Give me just a second, and I'll tell you where it was. It was on an attraction. It was on a poster for this event.
Well, while Sam looks for that, we obviously can't cover all of the news because there's things that come out every single day. So anything that we didn't cover, you guys definitely want to go to the DisneyNerdsPodcast.com. We try to post stuff there every day. I know that I do try to post even stuff that Disney might not announce, but if I find cool merchandise stuff, you know, I put it on there because if you guys are like me, we want to get some Disney stuff too to help with our addiction.
It is premiering on July the 21st.
Oh, mark my calendar.
It is a really cool attractions poster.
I would totally hang that up in my office.
It is cool. So July 21st, behind the attraction. And you know what? The Dwayne The Rock Johnson is producer on a couple of these things, which is really cool.
Yeah. And his movie's coming out. We got Jungle Cruise to look forward to this month, too.
I can't wait for Jungle Cruise. I have been counting down for that film to finally come out. And unfortunately, it was delayed with COVID. So I'm really looking forward to it. I think that'll be my first movie back in the theaters, if possible. So.
Yeah. Well, Black Widow comes out this weekend. I've been looking forward to that just as much. I think Black Widow is probably my favorite Marvel character. So this weekend, I will be in the theaters watching Black Widow. I already told my boyfriend, we're watching it this weekend. Like, we're not waiting. Opening weekend, I must see the Black Widow. And I'm going to do the same with Jungle Cruise.
All right. There was a lot of news in a small period of time to get everyone caught up. What news are you most looking forward to experience in the parks? Jimmy, tell us how you can get a hold of the show.
You can email us at questions@thedisneynerdspodcast.com and email us individually at ed@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, jimmy@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, etc. You can send us a message on Facebook to the page, The Disney Nerds Podcast. Join our group, Disney Nerds. Instagram @TheDisneyNerdsPodcast and Twitter @TheDisneyNerds. Make sure to check out the website, www.TheDisneyNerdsPodcast.com, and watch the live stream every Tuesday night at 9 o'clock Walt Disney World time.
Well, thanks for joining us, and we look forward to you joining us on next week's episode. For Sam and Morgan, this is Mellissa, and we are the Disney Nerds.
Kongaloosh!
Have a magical night. Hakuna Matata.
If you would like to join our jamboree, there's a simple rule that's compulsory.